Hello， 大家好，欢迎来到 A Talk 英语访谈。今天我们很荣幸邀请到了来自亚马逊的前首席科学家 Social Data Lab 的创始人，同时还是新书 Data for the People 的作者 Dr. Andreas Weigend 博士来到我们的节目演播现场。他有很多的故事、经验和知识与大家分享。让我们开始今天的访谈吧。Hi, Andreas. Thank you so much for coming. It's a real honor to have you here.
你好 ，Alan. It means Alan talk, right?
No. A talk actually means Andreas talk. Just kidding. A talk. A stands for accentuated, and also A stands for top quality because we have high-profile people like you to join
us. I thought A stands for getting the attention of the audience because that really is the currency of the world we live in.
Wow, that's very good insight. I totally agree with you. We know many people are quite curious about your work experience. I know you work as a former chief scientist at Amazon. Could you tell us, in the first place, why Amazon needed a chief scientist?
So, Amazon realized that innovation is based on being able to do experiments. So, they thought,Who knows about how to conduct experiments and to deal with the data that are coming out of experiments? And they thought physicists are quite good. So I got my PhD at Stanford in physics and I worked on neural networks and I've always loved to see what we can do with the data people create. So when Jeff Bezos was thinking about hiring a chief scientist, well, that was the choice he made.And it was actually an amazing experience to study millions and millions of people in real time by changing options and see how they react.
So in the end, what did you learn at Amazon, you think?
Well, we learned that often the revealed preferences are more important than the stated preferences.So people might state that they like to read Hegel or Immanuel Kant, or that they watch some highbrow films, but you at NetEase, you know what they actually watch.
Well, while they're watching us, we're watching them at the same time. So I'm sure you're definitely an expert in this field. And what do you think are the driving forces for consumers' behavior?
Well, there is the traditional ABC.Of consumer behavior.
ABC? Sounds interesting.
A standing for attention.
Mm-hmm.
B standing for belonging, that people want to be something bigger than themselves. And C stands for conversation. So I actually started off studying electrical engineering. And they told us that the purpose of communication is to transmit information.
Mm-hmm.
Mark Zuckerberg, the Facebook founder, he realized it is the other way around, that information can serve as an excuse for communication. So that's why I think the conversational aspect is very important, that people want to share what they think about a product, and in our ways of formulating trust, of knowing what product to buy, of whom to trust,I think the comments that others leave are very important. So I invite you to leave your comments below the video here because that's how other people know that they can trust you.
And also, know you recently wrote a book called Data for the People, is that right?
Yeah.
Can you tell us a bit about this book? Why did you write it and what's the book for?
So, the book really...started when I was at Amazon a long time ago because there were some principles how we thought of the user that were guiding principles and I would call them the data rights, the rights the users have to the data they create and share.
Data rights.
For example, one right is that you have the right to access your data. And things are not as easy as they sound. President Obama said that last year, that you have the right to your data. But what does it mean? For instance, if you leave a comment here after the video, and then somebody else comments in your comments, and you take your comment off, that poor other comment is sitting there in a vacuum, orphaned.
No context.
Yeah. So I think context, when we thought about the ABC, attention, belonging, and conversation, a good competitor for conversation was context.
You know, I Google searched you, and on your Wikipedia introduction, and there was an interesting thing that you that was mentioned there. You came up with a really interesting metaphor calling data the new oil. I'm very curious about it. Can you tell us why you called data new oil?
So first of all, I didn't invent the term data is new oil. Many people did that before me. But it was a good term, and I used it in a speech I gave to the General Assembly of the United Nations. Uh-huh. And now what does it mean? First of all, we could say data is a new oil, or we could say data is a new soil. Where the difference, of course, is that oil gets used up, soil doesn't. Mm-hmm. Or is data more like the new nukes, the new nuclear weapons?
That's powerful.
If they blow up, things can get very bad, as we saw, for instance, with Sony Pictures.
Wow.
So, but I chose the metaphor data is a new oil to emphasize that oil needs to be refined to actually become useful.
Yeah, then you can really have the value of oil after the oil is refined. So it's the same with data?
Same with data.
But how can data be refined?
Well, data can be refined by taking lots of data, and then maybe you add your data to it, and it will give you some data product which is of interest to you, or more specifically, which helps you make a better decision.
Oh, I see. Can you give us more specific examples how we can use data to help us make the right decisions?
Here we are in lovely Beijing, known for its smooth traffic.
Smooth.
So one example is that if you use a navigator in your car, that navigator getting a signal from GPS, but pings in the US, I use Google, here you have other navigators, pings some server somewhere for getting directions. By getting those directions, it also gives its current location. And what's important for me is that it is not because these evil companies want to know where you are. No, you want to get directions. And in order to tell you what to do at the next intersection, you have to tell that company A, where you are, and B, where you want to be going.
Very good. Mm-hmm.
And the refinery means it takes those data, not only of your car, but of a million cars, and now knows exactly how the traffic is flowing and can help you make better decisions. And let me add something to this.
Yes.
A couple of weeks ago, I was in Germany, and I met the person from Bosch, which makes car parts, whose job is to whatever Bosch makes should be connected to the internet. And an example he gave, I was very impressed by, which was that Bosch makes automatic parking systems. So you tell your car, park now, and it just parks for you. That means they have cameras in there which measure when there's an empty parking spot, and they use that information, that data, to simply report to some central database that there's a parking spot. So let's say you want to go to the theater in the evening, and you tell your navigator, I need to find a parking spot, and might even tell you before you reach the theater that that parking spot 50 meters from now coming up is the last free one before you get there. That is an example of a data refinery.
Wow, quite fascinating. And also, I think from what you just so told me, and really, in order to make use of the data, to have the result of data refinery, first you have to give out your own data to give first before you can really take the benefits from the data refinery. Is that right?
That is very true. I have some colleagues in the United States, and even more so in Germany, who pride themselves of not being on Facebook.
Not being on Facebook?
Yeah.
Why?
I don't know, but they think that's an achievement. And one of them actually tried it. He made an account, and there was nothing there. So the difference between NetEase, where you can go and you can watch relevant content like about the Olympics, mm-hmm. and Facebook is that unless you actually provide data to it, like have some of your friends, for instance, accept your friend requests, unless you do this, there's nothing to be refined. It is collaboration.
Yes.
And I think that the best products which we have seen are always products that combine what people are good at with what computers are good at.
Very good. So let computer do what they are good at, and let people do what they are good at.
Well said.
Thank you. My next question is, what do you think of the trade-off between public good and privacy? You know, nowadays, it's so easy for us to have access to all the data, massive data out there. And that also means people may have easy access to your own data, your privacy as well. So how can we maintain this balance? Or does it mean we have to sacrifice our privacy in order to get all the data there to make use of the data?
Well, the same technology that is used in some countries to capture terrorists is used in other countries to capture dissidents. So it is not really about the technology here. What we have to do is we have as society to make decisions on where do we want to be in this trade-off. In the European Union, for instance, there is a law which is the right to be forgotten. And what that means is if you write to Google and say, when you have a search result, this sketchy result comes up and I do not want to have that attached to my name. Mm-hmm. Then there is a human being at Google who makes that decision whether in the public good, we better leave that information on that Andreas was bankrupt 73 times. Or they decide, oh, that is the past. We don't have to worry about this. You are right. We'll take it off. So I don't think that there is sort of a general way of saying this is good and this is bad. The lawmakers in the EU decided that they can't make a general rule. So interesting enough, they pushed the decision up to Google to make that decision when somebody wants to be delisted, when somebody wants to have that search result taken out of when somebody searches for them.
Google can really do that.
It's Google's job. So that's what Google agreed to in the EU. And it shows us the question of data literacy.
Mm-hmm.
Because
what is data literacy?
Data literacy means that you know how to deal with data. So what is literacy? 500 years ago, if you went to church and could make out what the priest was saying in Latin, that this is what was written in the Bible, you were literate.
Mm-hmm.
Nowadays, that doesn't quite cut it anymore. So what we need now is that we know how to deal with the rich information which we are getting. To know when it seems that some comments, for instance, the comments below this movie here, are actually fake. That is data literacy. To know what you can trust, to know who you can trust, and what you cannot trust.
So in this step, we need to really use our brain, our own judgment, to really differentiate them, whether those comments are real or false, to tell the differences.
Yeah.
So if we use data and our brain in the right process of making a decision, then we can pretty much always make right decisions in the end.
We will never be sure. That's another thing. In the world of small data, we could be sure. In the world of big data, you never know about an individual data point, whether it's correct or not.
So there are always some uncertainties out there.
Yes. But if you have lots of data, you can build pretty good models, which have a good chance that you can make the right decision.
Very good. Can you give us an example of using data to help us in our daily life?
In our daily life, from which route do I take, which would be based on the data people's navigators report as they have other people drive, to where do I stay, which hotel do I use, or something like couch surfing or Airbnb, or where do I go and eat?
Yes, yes. We have that kind of service, especially young people like to use that service very often.
And not only where do I go to eat, what I learned from my students is once we're at the restaurant, they even open their mobile phone and figure out what to eat there.
Exactly. You see the recommendation from the users.
Exactly. The pictures people take.
Yes, yes. But sometimes, how can you know whether those pictures are the real ones or the ones that paid to post there?
Answer is through social data. Because we now have the metadata. We know on that account what other things that person has posted.
Yes.
And there is an airline in one of the countries I live in who I did some work for. And they proudly told me how active their users were on a social network. And then we looked, and it turned out that most of their users, quote unquote, were cam girls from the Philippines who were in their spare time for a few bucks when they were not busy in front of the camera. They posted how wonderful it is to fly with the airline and so on. And they did it not only with that airline, but with any other airline as well.
And so they get paid from the airlines.
Exactly. Yeah. So that was one of the examples. By seeing what other things that person had posted, when you realize how funny is this.
Then you use social media to find out the truth.
Yes, and it also shows you a very important point. You asked before what I did at Amazon, and I answered it by doing experiments and convincing people that experiments is a good way. Mm-hmm. What I didn't say is, you need to figure out, before you do the experiment, what does it mean to do well? What does it mean to do poorly?
Yeah, you have to have a clear goal.
Yeah. You have to know how you measure things, and you have to know how you put things together into an equation, or sometimes I say a fitness function, in some metric which tells you how well you're doing. Because you do one experiment with A and you have B, and unless you know what you actually think is good and what you think is not so good, you won't learn. And from an organizational perspective, it's much easier to agree on the equation before the outcome has come than after it's in and egos are involved. It applies to your personal life as well. And in this world of big data, what would you say if the next time you're watching NetEase, they say, Alan, you have spent enough time watching things, time to do real work.
So they'll tell you, right, we use the data to give you the feedback. Certain things you shouldn't be spending much time on. You shall switch your attention to something else.
I heard, actually, 10 years ago, when I was at the internet bar in Chengdu, I heard that after a certain number of hours, that they had to put in software that shut down the account to avoid internet gaming addiction.
But what's the point from the corporation's perspective? Will they help them to make money or make money?
No, it's
money?
The government. It's the government which decides it's not good for our future if people spend their time playing games.
That's good. That's a good reminder.
So in these cases, when the machine knows what would make us happy, and we don't do it, but should we surrender to the machine?
Does that mean maybe machine, in some extent, may know us better than we know ourselves?
Probably. I think that people overestimate how well they know themselves and underestimate how well the internet companies know them. Take a totally different example. Take your mobility patterns. Your phone company knows where you are. It even knows, you know, where you should not be. So that is a different world to live in. And data literacy means that we learn the judgment of maybe what not to look at.
The data source is everywhere. It can be anything. So if you really have the data literacy, then, you know, you can really better protect yourself. We have like mobile phone, like sensors are out there recording our data. So you have to be really cautious whenever, wherever you go or whatever you do. Otherwise, everything becomes transparent.
Yeah. With face recognition being as good as it is, we don't need our ID cards anymore. We can just show up.
Yeah, I like that idea, really. Yeah, that would be more efficient. Then the line at the airport will be much shorter if everyone is really using the face recognition technology.
Or gait recognition. As people are walking over the campus here, the corporate campus, you can have cameras that just know from the way a person walks who it is. Wow. And if somebody is walking at the time of day when they shouldn't be walking there, you can have the security guards check them out.
Wow. It really depends on the mood, right? Maybe sometimes when you're in a good mood, you may behave or walk in a certain way. But sometimes when you're in a not really good mood, in a bad mood, mm-hmm. you may walk in a different way. Or even when you're sick, right?
Yeah, push that further. Yeah. Depression is a common problem in the world.
Yes.
And who knows better than you're depressed than your phone? Because your patterns of calling people change. Your voice in which you speak changes.
Yes.
And why not use that data and refine the data and help the person?
Very good. That's really, yeah, really good usage of data to help you better understand yourself and others. I really like that idea.
For a year, I was wearing Google Glass every day. And it was an interesting experiment because I wanted to understand why do people react so negatively for me wearing glass. And I isolated a few things. One of them, people weren't sure whether I actually was paying attention to them or whether I was looking at this little thing which was projected onto my retina.
Maybe both.
Yeah, two. They were worried, of course, because I pretended it to be the case, that I was looking up things about them as we were talking. I might have seen their name tag before, but I didn't say, "I saw your name tag." I said, "Are you Alan?" Uh-huh. And so now they get insecure because there's this information asymmetry that they thought it was a level playing field, but it turns out that he knows something about me. What else does he know? The third one was the most scary one for all of them, that it could be recording. Mm-hmm. So right now, something he or she says, and I say that's what they said was, what he said was what I said. If I have that recording, then now suddenly they realize that the many things they say, something can be misconstrued without context.
Yes, yes. Then it brings us back to the context we previously talked about. Very important. Without context, certain opinions are really just isolated. It can be really easily be misinterpreted.
Yeah. So whether it is using the social context of knowing who your friends are, or of knowing who the friends are of the person who posted something, or whether it's the physical context, whether you're standing outside in the cold in Beijing, or whether you're comfortable at your home. Mm-hmm. That context should change what the data refinery presents to you. Actually, I have a whole chapter on context and connections in my book, because I personally think that the sensors that we built, the billions of sensors that we have in the world through our mobile phones alone.
Billions of sensors? That many?
We have a billion phones. Each phone has 10 sensors, and we have 10 billion sensors. Wow. You know, I'm a physicist. Data literacy also means you do order of magnitude.
Very impressed, yes.
You know, it's easy. That's what I mean by data literacy. That if you tell me it's a trillion, then I say that can't be the case. If you ask me, how do you know it's not 100 million? I say, because you have a billion phones, and every phone has a microphone in it.
Yes, yes. And not just phones, there are other sensors out there as well, right?
Yeah. So, and now we live in a world where all this data can be used for the people. And in my book, I make the point that I want to have a higher likelihood that it gets used for the people as opposed to getting used against the people.
I think I can't wait to read your book. It's a real guide to us, to help us make right decisions using data.
That's the goal.
Excellent.
Thank you, Alan.
Social data revolution is also a course you're teaching at the moment, right? Can you tell us first, what does social mean here? Does social mean society in general, or social media, or both combined, in your opinion?
So the course, Social Data Revolution, I've taught every year for, I think, about 8 years now. Mm-hmm. And I teach it again this fall at the University of California at Berkeley. Mm-hmm. All my classes are online. Maybe we can have them that
definitely,
you can put
them
on.
Yeah. Okay. In the near future, and Andrew's Social Data Revolution course will be available on our website on Medi's online open courses.
So for free?
Definitely, for free, with subtitles.
Okay. Yeah. So, back to the question, what does social mean? Yeah. Social means sharing. So, I socialize my data means I share my data. Mm-hmm. Social also has a connotation of a social networking site, of the connections between people being more important than the attributes about people. But all of that coming together formed that revolution which has changed the way a billion people think about who they are.
Mm, I can really sense, feel the revolution.
Which has changed the way a billion people think about information.
Why?
I mean, before we had search engines, mm-hmm. How was that when you couldn't just discreetly at dinner quickly look something up? I think it's fundamentally changed the way how people view the world. Universities used to teach people how to answer questions.
But usually there are more than one answer to each question.
I think we need to teach people how to ask questions.
That's a good point, yeah.
Because as you said, yeah, there are many answers, and the search engines can deliver those to us.
Mm-hmm.
So that is no longer something which sets one person apart from another person. If you know how to type some search query, you all get the same answers.
Mm-hmm.
What sets a person apart is, can they ask good questions?
But how do we define good questions then?
Well, I think we go back to the Greek.
Greek?
We go back to Plato. And among the things which he said is that things emerge in discussion, in conversation. So I actually end my book in looking at the world and saying, well, maybe the world we live in now, with all that information at our fingertips, yet is no different than Plato's allegory of the cave. In his allegory of the cave, you had a few prisoners who were all looking at the wall inside the cave.
Mm-hmm.
And on that wall, they see shadows of maybe puppets, maybe people from the outside projected onto that wall. That's all they knew. And they made sense out of it. And I wonder, is the same true for us? That all we know is the world according to the internet giants.
Yeah.
And if we try, it's like the prisoners who escaped. And they looked into the bright light and they couldn't see anything. So the answer to your question is, how do we know? By taking time to reflect.
Time will reveal, right, in the end. And I'm sure also, by reading your book, you provide a guidance how to really make sense of the massive and also messy data out there.
Or at least I try to tell some stories which people find interesting.
What do you think was going to happen in the next 10 years regarding the social data revolution?
So there are two standard answers. One is the best way to predict the future is to create it. That was Alvin Kay. The other one is to say, and that's more the Chinese way, is to look into the past in order to predict the future. So 10 years. About 10 years ago, in Shanghai, at Shanghai Zhao Jia Dashi, there was a debate where the university had invited Jack Ma and me to debate the future of e-commerce. And it was a very good conversation. And I know many things we agreed on, for instance, the importance of quantifying things. And I looked at the transcript the other day, and I was struck that neither he nor I, in the year 2004, had any mention of the word mobile. So, and it was true, in 2004, there was no smartphone. It was way before the iPhone.
No iPhone, yeah. Only 12 years ago, right?
12 years ago. So I think when people ask me to make predictions, I always realize that the hardest thing to predict are those who have just no idea at the time. So nobody would have talked about, and Alibaba existed, Amazon existed, and so on. Nobody would have talked about whatever is now 80% of all orders coming in through the mobile phone. So I fear that whatever I say, people will make fun of. In not 10 years, but in 5 years, to say, Andreas didn't even know XYZ. What I do believe in, however, is if I look back for the next 10, 20 years, almost all innovations I know were based on data. Even the innovation of the physical world, like DD, that change from having taxis driving around or finding people to put in a taxi to flipping that and finding taxis for the people. That is one of the examples which is a data play. And I think many entrepreneurs here in Beijing, here in China, who are looking for interesting startups. And I always think about the data. You can get off the people and by the people. And if you make those data for the people, you win.
Wow, that's good. Very good point. Of people, by the people, then I'll make the data for the people. If you have those three things, then you are able to be successful. So one thing for sure is great things will happen in the future. And also the unknown. That's what makes the future exciting.
Absolutely.
Hi, Andreas, thank you so much for coming. I really appreciate everything you've shared here with us and the audience today. 观众朋友们，非常感谢今天参加我们的分享。如果您想关注更多关于 Dr. Andreas Weigend 先生的事情的话，请关注网易公开课他的专栏。Andreas, let's say goodbye to the audience, shall we?
Goodbye, thank you for watching, leave your comments, and we are watching you too.
See you next time. Everything black and white. I'm a tortured villain in a Hitchcock film, no end in sight. Living in fluorescent light. I see every spider, I feel every fiber that I try to hide. Gotta keep up.
hear the voices keep saying, never give up, there's no such thing as failing.
Every
coming back.
No such thing as failure.